Hotel Podcast, a global conversation hosted by Alex Rezvan-Bionet.
Hello and welcome back to another episode of the Retail Podcast. And if I'm smiling like a child, it's because I feel that Christmas has come early in the sense of who we're going to talk to today. Kaave Pour has been on my radar to get on this podcast since day one, because when I saw him speak 2 years ago, it just the passion, the conviction and the difference in thinking was mind-blowing. If you don't know who he is, he's the co-founder and director at SPACE10, which is a research and design lab funded, I think wholly owned by IKEA. Is that right?
Yeah, it's. I would say it's complicated.
Oh, okay.
We are fully funded by IKEA. We work exclusively with IKEA, but we are operating independently and not owned by IKEA.
Got you. And so in terms of the stuff that you do, and I'll list some of these because I love getting your newsletters. And again, it's a mini Christmas for me every time I get one of these newsletters and I look at what you're doing. But there's some serious elements of this. It's not all just beautiful design and stuff that's out there. It's stuff that you make it real. And I'll give you the example that I use in my meetings today. When you talk about the future, you challenge people's perspective. For example, around autonomous cars, do you see this aluminium glass? These are your words that just sort of sunk into my head. Do you see aluminium and glass, or do you see a friendlier, kinder sort of community hub as an autonomous vehicle? And you did that as a project and research. But you look at some of the stuff that you've done, and I'll just go through this sort of list of amazingness. Building a fort without mess. The eight experiments that you're doing currently with the agencies in these themes about the home and how technology plays a part in the home. And I, you know, if you do one thing, go onto the website, have a look at some of the videos that have been created that have just, you know, for example, I'll give you another. If you could see light and its impact in the room from your lamp through sound, what would that be like? And as music travels through your house, that visualizes and you can see. And there's a short little video. It's just beautiful in that sense. I can carry on, and I've got a whole list of here stuff. Actually, there is one other one that was really serious, but I just thought the way that you talked about in terms of not Black Lives Matter specifically, but the conversation you had about inclusivity from a language perspective and how some of this sort of systems and barriers that are created through language. And so, as I said, thank you so much for giving me some time and coming to the podcast. I know I can only imagine how life is for you. Are you currently in? I can see you're not in the studio. Is the studio currently open?
No, yeah, the studio is currently open, but only 50%. So, like, we have some of our team members, they're working from the studio, but we try to only be there if it's really necessary at the moment, and some of us are working remote. I'm currently in Sweden at my farm in the middle of nowhere in a big forest. So, Luckily, Sweden, they have fiber connection, so it should be okay with the call.
Yeah. So as I mentioned, you have a whole plethora of different types of projects that you are working on or have worked on. And you also collaborate with the best minds in terms of some of the best universities, MIT, Harvard. So you've got sort of a who's who of collaborations as well. What, given the tough environment that we are in because of COVID, what's at the top of your mind right now? What are you focused on?
That's a good question. I think obviously what we are seeing right now in relation to people's life situation at home, the role of the home has increased in terms of importance more than it has maybe done in a long time. And for us, it's quite interesting that we are right now, you could say, both talking about the home as a sanctuary, a place where some people who are lucky and fortunate enough to stay at home, work from home, exercise from home, teach their kids at home, And on the other side, we're also seeing that for many people, the home almost turns into a prison, a place where they are not comfortable, where they feel lonely, anxious. There might be domestic violence. There might be challenges in terms of self-expression. You could say right now, that conversation around how to truly design democratic solutions that are available for all, and how the home will be that new platform for many both companies and ideas to flourish, is something that we feel is very exciting, but also a very big responsibility to understand properly. And something where right now we talk a lot about finding chaos, finding patterns in the chaos. And I think right now finding those patterns in an extreme chaotic environment as we are living in right now is increasingly important for a research and design lab like us.
See, I find a lot of the work that you do. So in terms of, are you empathetic by design? Are you like, is that just a natural character of you? Because a lot of your work has this empathetic, the breathable element. And I'm like thinking, and going back to what you're talking about, the design, is that by design? That's just the way that you guys are.
Yeah, I think it's probably a combination of both. Space10 is definitely driven in terms of why we're doing what we do. For us in today's environment, you can do so much. Almost everything is possible nowadays. Technology is one, a closer world is one. But like now the question is not really what can we do, but should we do it? And what should we do? And suddenly the priorities or the simplicity that you need to suddenly find, it will be increasingly important. And for Space10, you could say our overall vision is to try to research and design better ways for people to live a better everyday life. So the things that are often connected to the very mundane, relaxed, chill, low-key life. And for us, that's very important that what we do always taps back into that. And that can be in various directions, but like if it doesn't really connect to that on the personal level, why the heck should we then do it?
Yeah.
But also from a business point of view, you know, the best way to validate an idea is whether that idea truly brings value to people's life. And if you do that, you are quite likely to succeed. What we do have seen is that often a lot of the great ideas are not really available for the many. It's often quite exclusive when you talk about design and who are able to buy access to good products and services. And you could say our quest is to really understand how research and design can influence people's life at home, but also how we can democratize access to those ideas, either by price or by relevancy, accessibility, etc.
I feel that you, in the introduction part, you spoke about something that quite, as someone who sort of promotes mental well-being, and specifically we're coming into Movember in the UK, well, it's a global thing where we talk about mental health and issues. I feel I've done a bit of a disjustice, just jumped into because I'm so excited, but then forgot some of the sort of deeper things that you were talking about the psychology of how we are at home 24 hours, or obviously more than we were in the past. We're not commuting, and some of the challenges that raises. So is that shaping, because I know you've done projects on sort of sustainable living and better living, as in how does design create happier spaces? Mm-hmm. So are you, when you're thinking about these themes, about the challenges that we have, are you then sort of interpreting that into your work in terms of how creating, I mean, do you feel that it's a space thing? You can create better moods and happiness through space?
Yeah, I think, you know, the way we approach it is you could say we are working with IKEA, and you could say IKEA is working obviously very closely with spaces and with the home. And our you could say mission is to find a way to create these better everyday lives. And together with IKEA, we believe that a home will create a better everyday life. A better home equals a better everyday life. People spend a vast amount of time indoor. They spend a vast amount of time in their home. And the home is not just a place for sleeping and eating. It's also a safe place for some, a social place, a private space. But like the role of that home is dramatically changing. And I think the pattern in our chaotic body of work at Space 10 always connects into spaces and into homes. Whether it's how we design and build our homes, how technology is influencing life at home, how we, from an architectural point of view, could build better and more resilient homes. Where are those homes in a world where augmented reality and computer vision starts to blend in with the physical space? And what are those homes then? You know, so I think even though for some it might look like shit, that's all over the place. You guys are working in so many verticals that there's not really a red thread. But at the end, if you zoom in, it is really the home and spaces that we are extremely fascinated by. And we believe that if we can really find out what are the opportunities in terms of designing better homes and better spaces, we can influence a lot of people by just tapping into what they already have today.
I love what you, I mean, so in my mind, it's not chaotic. I actually do see a natural thread through what you've done. For example, your future food project, where you were looking at, and I haven't done this yet, but the coffee cake or using coffee to make another product that's consumable after. I do see this sort of common theme that goes through it. And one of the other projects that I'd love to sort of, I don't know, hear a little bit more about was the when SPACE10 and Quicksand visited 40 families around the world, where you then looked at the energy and how you could live life without energy. Was that someone who worked for you, or were you able to personally go out and meet those families?
Yes, that's a good question. So like the way we focus at the moment is that obviously we have that big broad umbrella around the people's everyday life and how the societal, the environmental, and even the technological shifts will likely influence that everyday life. And then we try to find out where the opportunities to connect that with people's homes are today and tomorrow. But what we also do is that we have, you could say, more specific areas of focus where we are seeing, can we identify some patterns that are really on a big scale, potentially influencing these spaces? One of them is a focus on what we would call spatial computing, or the fact that IoT and augmented reality are dramatically changing our perception of space and how we interact with them. And you could say that is maybe more a focus on people who already today are using technology quite frequently in their lives. But we also identified that there is a way broader and bigger need in terms of how technology will play a role in people's home. And that is into what we would call home essentials. So what are the essentials for a life at home, basically? We talk a lot about the basics, and today people are launching smart speakers and smart TVs and smart toasters and smart thermostats and cameras in every room. And I think with Space 10, we are quite skeptical that that is really what people need and where companies not only should, but also could do great business. Whereas if you look at something like energy, there is almost 3.5 billion people across the globe who today have little or unreliable access to electricity.
Right.
And that's actually way higher than some of the official numbers from the UN, because in certain countries, like, for example, in India, you see many people only having maybe 4 to 6 hours of reliable electricity a day, and they would then be connected to the grid in official numbers. So that is obviously not really a great foundation for building a livelihood. And suddenly the smart home for us becomes very, very interesting, right? Because then it's not just about entertainment and productivity. It's also about essential living. Clean water, clean air, clean energy, cooking, and how technology and new products and services can kind of like bridge the gap will likely be a far more important task for for us going forward than the other one that already seems quite populated. So, you know, starting with that, obviously, then how the heck do you go about that when you suddenly have a very, very different group of people who you have to design not just for, but design with? And here our starting point is often just to meet those people, like, who are they? How do they live? And most importantly, not just ask, what are your problems? You know, everybody asks, what are your problems? We need a big problem to solve. And for us, I think, you know, solving a problem is just to fix something broken. It's to reach zero. But asking not just what problems they are facing, but also what are their dreams? What are their aspirations? Suddenly gives you very, very different answers. And we went out and asked a bunch of lovely families and people from across many, many countries, what are your challenges with living without electricity today? But if you could, what would you then ideally have? What would you dream of? Yeah. And we made a little report. Some of it is public, so everybody can browse through it. And based on that and a few other projects, we're now looking even more into how we, together with IKEA, could potentially provide new solutions for that demographic.
I got you. Yeah, I mean, it was a fascinating read, and the countries, Kenya, Peru, Indonesia, India. I mean, there was a great book, Foundness. I don't know if you've read it. And in that book, it talks about the energy deficiency and solve the problem for the 3% of the world, and the world is a better place by proxy. So I love that. You've mentioned technology quite a lot, which I don't know if you're doing that because, you know, I work at Microsoft, or it's something that's close to your heart. And technology manifests itself in different ways for you, from the way that I've seen it. What do you see as being the future relationship with technology? Because you sort of said, you made a comment about the, you know, whether or not we're filling our houses with smart speakers and everything. How do you see the future of technology with us?
Yeah, I think when talking about the future, it's always good to sometimes understand how the heck we ended where we are today. And
yes,
with technology, at least how we from SPACE10 like to see it, is that, you know, we move through these different key phases where certain technologies, they go from a crazy idea into something that is scale to billions of people. And you know, one key interesting area is, for example, the desktop computing area, right? So like, we had the computers at work, and then, you know, suddenly you could get those big computers at home, and you maybe had to build a little desk or buy a desk, and then you would have your computer at home, and then suddenly that computer went from the desk to your lap, and suddenly you became a little bit more mobile, and a few more people had access to this, and changed quite a lot of how we worked and how we connected with each other. And then you could say in the last 10-15 years, obviously the smartphone has been the big platform of what we would then call a move from desktop computing to mobile computing.
Yeah.
And suddenly, you know, everything moved from your desk to the palm of your hand and became extremely accessible in a pace I don't think many really projected. And mobile computing for us is not just the phone, it's also, you know, the headphones that you are bringing with you, or the smartwatch that you're bringing with you. And you could say right now we are at a phase where it's quite clear that we will probably not live until we get an iPhone 26. You know, like at some point, the technology is at a point where the innovations are moving away from the actual hardware and software that the big companies like Apple and Microsoft are launching. And it's moving a lot more onto the layers on top of those platforms and the innovations that others are creating by utilizing those big platforms. So now it's more the mobility grid that is enabled by these smartphones, or new music streaming, new ways of dating, new ways of cooking, new ways of traveling. And all those layers are obviously all enabled by that little phone. But what we are keen on understanding is, like, where are we seeing patterns towards where the next wave will be? And what we tend to see is that we are now moving from mobile computing to what we would call spatial computing. And I know that there's many terms for this, but for us, how we see it is that we are moving from technology being something that is connected and with you as a person all the time to something that is a lot more embedded into the spaces that you spend your everyday life in. That would include IoT products that are not just within your home, but also within the city. But we're also seeing augmented reality and mixed reality really becoming more and more ready for scale, where suddenly people will not look at their screens anymore. They will look
through their screens. Yes.
And suddenly, you know, both the role as a designer, but also as a company, you know, how do you navigate that? Suddenly everything is not a limited fixed visual real estate, but suddenly something that needs to be a lot more dynamic. And all of that obviously are being combined with you could say AI or I think, you know, some say that if it's written in PowerPoint, you call it AI, and if it's written in Python, you call it machine learning. But the overall goal is obviously that those three combined will likely change our perception of technology quite dramatically over the next 10 years. And I think that will be a conversation that will surprise a lot how fast that will come. And it will also be the first time where we will really seriously talk about privacy and security when it comes to technology, because it's easier to put your phone away. But if it's a pair of glasses that you're wearing, or if it's a product within your very intimate space at home, people will have very different criterias. So I don't think it will probably be more complex than ever to make something simple. But the ones who will manage to do so will be very powerful.
I'd love your opinion on this. I've had a few different guests, and we've talked about human behavior during COVID and how I'll give you the retail use case, and then I'd love your sort of thoughts on this. So in the retail use cases, if you change the customer journey, for example, for 6 weeks or 6 months, then you've changed it for life. And that sort of resonated with me. But then I had another guest who sort of said, well, actually, that's not true, because if you look at human development and how we got here, that was through the evolution of the things that led us here. So almost saying that, yeah, it may have changed for 6 months, but your human nature will lead you back to, so for example, you flying, or lead you back to face-to-face meetings, less time working from home. And it made me think, and I don't have an answer to it, but I love your perspective on, do you think we will sort of, once we get through this phase, will we be in a new world? Whatever the, you know, I don't like to say new normal, because whatever that is, or do you feel that we will actually change? This has changed us in some way.
Yeah, I definitely think that like COVID has been some sort of accelerator of what has already been happening, but maybe not as obvious as it is right now. Yeah. You know, remote work was something that was discussed already beforehand. You know, health and hygiene and services related to that were already emerging. We also saw that more and more trends around people slowly moving out of the cities again, at least in certain markets, moving more out to the countryside. You know, the social communal living. So some of the things that has accelerated through COVID, e-commerce and buying online is another great example of it. So in that sense, I think, you know, some of these shifts is for sure happening no matter what. But I guess the problem is that we as people always try to find a very, very simple answer for something that is very, very complex, right? Like there's more than 7 billion people in the world. And, you know, in terms of behavior for, let's say, retail, as you asked, like if you go to a country like India, where like the vast amount of the population is extremely young and very progressive in terms of new ways of doing it, versus and maybe a more mature market like Denmark, where change is not happening as fast in terms of focus, you will likely see very different shifts. So I would assume that especially younger generations, at least the ones that we are focused quite a lot on, a lot more ready to shift behavior than maybe some of the generations who have been used to the ways we do things today. So, a long story short, everything will definitely not go back to normal. But obviously, there is a few fundamental things that we will still keep. There's this famous saying from why are people moving to the city? And there's been a lot of research based on that. And they said that there's three key reasons. One reason is that you are moving to the city for access to goods and services. You are moving to the city for economic opportunity through jobs or education, and you're moving to the city for a rich social life, right?
Yeah.
Be with others. And if you then look at what is happening right now, like access to goods and services, you do not have to move to the city to get that anymore. Access to education or economic opportunity, you do not have to move to the city in the same extent, at least within certain job categories today. And we're also seeing with both remote work and calls and smaller local community desires that even the social aspect of it, people would prefer moving out of the city and live in a lot smaller clusters than today. So the question is whether something like COVID will accelerate that, or whether we will go back and then not do these things before in 20 years from now, or whether actually there will be a higher velocity.
Was your move to the country yourself, I presume, was way before, because I think you'd already moved there in earlier this year. Is that right?
Yeah. We bought this farm a few years ago, and it's, there's no doubt that, like, I mean, if you look, let's say 20 or 30, 40, 50 years ahead, like, you will be able to live in so many more places than today, just due to the fact that we will have a lot more innovation coming into the energy space, to the connectivity space, and to the mobility space. So you will be able to choose a place to live without there necessarily being a big grid infrastructure for electricity in place.
Yeah.
You'll be able to move to whatever place, even though there might not be a fiber connection or any cables, because you will likely just be able to connect to a satellite. And third, like, you would probably also be able to live a lot further away and still be able to come to the city, or live further away and still get access to services and goods through self-driving cars and drones that will dramatically change, you could say, where people can move, where right now people are only moving to places where there is already quite a strong infrastructure in place.
Yeah.
If you remove that barrier, I'm very curious to see where people actually then would move to, because then price will be a very, very different aspect. But also restaurants and experimental retail, nightclubs, even schools will likely be able to locate themselves in the middle of nowhere, just where there's beautiful nature, or where it's strategically very close to X amount of cities that then could go to that one location for that one purpose. So I think, you know, for us, moving out of the city is primarily a personal reason, but I definitely also believe that from a life quality point of view, being able to be close to nature is something more and more people will look into.
Yeah, I agree. And I'm someone who's sort of always lived on the edge of things, although saying that, living in London right now is but anyway, on different things.
It's quite interesting in terms of, for example, you know, there's all these quotes around 70% or 68% of the world is going to live in urban areas by 2050, right? And like that's you can almost not go to any conference that are talking about future trends without that being mentioned.
Yeah.
And obviously that is likely true, but what people are missing is that talking about global numbers often is a skewed way of looking at the numbers, because the primary drive to cities is in Asia and it's in Africa. Whereas if you look at numbers from both Europe, but also from the US, both people's desire, and even in certain months, there is a negative growth rate to cities, including London a few times. So we are seeing small signs that there are actually a lot of people that are considering moving out, not just because of the price, but also because of the general opportunity.
I don't think we're seeing small signs. In the UK, we're seeing, having spoken to a couple of agents and everything, there are big signs that people have already decided with the enablement of what you were talking about, technology, that do they need to be where they are to do what they would have done? But I think the bigger consequence will be if the market contracts, then the job market will shift again. And I think that will then determine what choices and options people have. You talked about the future of retail, and you talked about, I know the time frame that you said was out there, but do you feel that we'll consume in the same way within stores and have to go into? Because again, one of your other projects was if we built a living environment and that environment, I guess the consumption model changes. But yeah, what's your view on the future of retail?
I mean, to be honest, I definitely hope that it will change a lot. And I also hope that we will consume a lot less. If you think about, you know, will things change or not, it's always helpful for me to just think about it almost as an alien who visited Earth and were trying to observe how we were doing things, and then would be asking, like, but does that really make sense? You know, there's this old kids book where an alien visited Earth, and the alien just do not understand why people, for example, are tanning on a beach, you know, becoming all red, and it's super bad for your skin, and yet we're all doing it. And you know, some of those logics around why are we actually doing it. And if you think about, for example, a supermarket, it doesn't make sense anymore to have that model where you have a lot of people who are placing products on the shelves, and then people take them and then you place them again. And you know, you have to move quite a lot to just visit that supermarket, and then you spend a lot of time within that supermarket to bring your products out to then go home and cook. And what you should make and how you should do it in a world where time is so important for people, where distance is important for people, and where price is important for people. So I think from a logical point of view, if people could choose not to spend that much time shopping and just get what they are getting from shopping, I think a lot of people would choose that. But the limitations are obviously either how we can do it from an operational point of view, or how we can do it from an affordability point of view. And those are right now the barriers that are, you could say, still keeping the more traditional retail industry alive, even though we are obviously seeing numbers that this is not alive, is maybe more struggling than alive. But I think, you know, as soon as we just look a little bit ahead, we will likely see that those patterns will change a lot. And then we will also see that things that we thought would be retail in a digital world is not even relevant as retail anymore. And I think looking at how the internet changed news is a great reference for how we will likely see retail changing too, where back in the days it made sense to buy a newspaper, right? And you had all the sections in it because it was easy, and you could read your football news and the stock news and the cultural news and the local news and the political news, and everything was like in this one easy go-to destination that you could buy and read once a day. But then the internet came, and certainly you could still very easily with just your phone visit all those different sections. But there were certainly people who just wanted to make one of the sections, but a lot better than what it was today. Yeah. And then suddenly you don't need to go to one destination to get both your stock news and your football news and your food news and your local news. You can go to different destinations, but as seamless as you could before throughout a newspaper. And when, you could say, the internet starts to lower the barriers for who can enter without the old ones fighting you off with some sort of big moat, things starts to move really, really fast. And retail is a great example of that. We have talked with IKEA, and obviously IKEA is fully aware that, you know, one of their big strengths were you could go to an IKEA store and then all furniture would be in that store. So whether it's a mattress or a table or a smart speaker, you can get it all under one roof. And the convenience of that is obviously extremely powerful. But now today online, you can buy your mattress from Casper, and you can buy your lamp from a small local studio through Shopify. You can buy some things on Amazon, some things on IKEA. But the journey from a customer's point of view is probably just you and your partner, or you and your friend, or you and your family browsing through, getting exact same offer, if not a broader offer than what IKEA would be able to provide. And with augmented reality, you can even see those in your home, test them out, try them out.
Yeah.
Suddenly, why would you ever then go and visit? And
well, I think there's one element. It's that, and it, maybe it's the uncomfortable element in retail. It's that psychological hit. You know, the endorphins, the dopamine, the feeling good, and the experience of shopping and what that has represented for the last 40 years. However, I'm really conscious that that doesn't mean that that's the future, because my children aren't being taken to the shopping malls like I was when I was little, right? They don't go to a shopping center. I used to go to a shopping center when I was little in Milton Keynes, where there was this brand new shopping center, and that was where we go. But my kids are like, they don't want to go. So I definitely see what you're saying. But then I think there's this human side of us that has to change. And that's, when will that trigger for change happen? I.e., we're not feeling excited by shopping because our lives are on a different, and this, you know, conversation will go off into another plane, but it's basically where are those needs being met? Because that's, sorry, go ahead.
No, but I think, I mean, first of all, I think, you know, obviously for some shopping is more of an activity than a logistical need, and yeah, that part of shopping might be different than the other part. But I think for younger generations, it's not that they don't get a kick out of it. I think it's more that they almost feel guilty sometimes about shopping too much, because they know what's going on in the world. And yeah, if we slowly start to flirt with that as a potential consequence, then the acceleration will just happen faster. But when that's said, I think it's also just to remember that, like, some things that we used to think was a natural part of retail suddenly now will likely be very different. You know, co-working spaces are a great example of that, where, you know, I remember with IKEA, we talked about their future of business to business, and suddenly, you know, the competitor was not just others who were providing furniture. It was also suddenly platforms that were not just providing furniture, they were also providing this actual space and the services and the coffee and everything in between as a full stack. The same is happening with co-living spaces, or in London, there's a lot of fully furnished apartments that are being leased rather than buying it themselves. And then suddenly, you know, the products that you use to connect with retail will now more be connected with service. The car industry is another one, right? Where, you know, I'm expecting a kid in January. I don't expect to buy.
Congratulations, by the way.
Thank you. But I do not expect to see her having a driver's license and go out and buy a car, right? And that was something that just 20 years ago would be like the most natural part, that retail and cars were two sides of the same coin, right? And 15 years from now, we will not even think about cars as part of retail.
Yeah.
And I think that is the most interesting part for me, is will we completely change our perception of retail to more be either something you do for the fun of it, for the excitement, or for the self-expression, and then the rest will just be pure logistics that you don't even buy, it just comes to you. Most of what people buy, I would assume, is not something where they get super excited about it. There might be a chunk of retail where people get excited about it, but like buying the mundane things like toilet paper and soap and new underwear, you know, those things, I think people would prefer not to spend a lot of time on in the near future.
So I feel that I've been on this journey with you, and I feel like I've gone 40 years into the future, have come back. I've had some of my horizons broadened in terms of this way of thinking about consumption, and, you know, not necessarily having shopping as entertainment, but having a sort of a cleaner and kinder future. Where does that leave you in terms of the direction of travel that you're going in and your future and Space10's future, given everything that's happened this year? Where do you see yourself going?
I think where we hope to go is to go towards a direction where we design for many futures. Like often the future is being talked about as a whole, as one destination. And I think, you know, the founder of Pixar actually once, he said, like, the future is not a destination, it's a direction. And honestly, that's super frustrating, right? Because you can never reach that future.
No. Moving.
And you will never, you know, be able to say now we reached that point, because it keeps evolving. And how you then take that notion that it keeps moving and combine that with the fact that we need to design inclusive and relevant solutions for billions of people obviously starts to trigger a lot of conversations around not just what we do, but also how we do it. And I think a lot of the conversation big companies and smaller studios will face is not necessarily the lack of good ideas or the lack of clear trends around where things will evolve, but it's more about how do we then work towards that. Our mantra is that we should never build anything to last, only thing should be built to evolve.
Right.
And if you from the beginning have that mindset that like what we put in the world will not be there in the same context in a year from now, then suddenly you start to design things that are very different. If you then also start to think what I put out in the world will likely not be something that brings value unless it's being thought through from multiple angles and with a very diverse team of people in a completely different collaboration than what normal companies today are approaching it with, then there's something interesting. And I think the conclusion for us is that like right now everyone is a little scared, right? Like, oh shit, everything is crazy.
Yeah.
The political world is crazy, the climate is crazy, people are protesting. And at the end you could say where most see an opposition, I think we see opportunity. And like this idea that collaboration will be competition in the near future, and how different companies and people will join forces to actually solve real problems and enable real dreams for people, rather than just looking at what they have in their offer today and trying to push that as far out as possible because then they can make some money on it. Those will be the key conversations that will happen in the near term, because especially the youth today, they are not taking any bullshit from anyone anymore. Even though for some that would be nice to push a little bit out in the future so we didn't have to deal with it, I think it's very refreshing that there's suddenly a lot more accountability that is being put back on companies. And whether it's the smart home and the question around privacy, or whether it's availability of design in terms of price, or whether it's inclusivity in terms of who are we not just designing for, but who are we designing with?
Yeah,
those will be the questions that will have companies succeed or fall, not the fact that technology or new innovations will accelerate faster than what they anticipated. And I think we have spent the last 5-10 years talking a lot about trends and final outcomes and buzzwords around technology. But 10 years will be a lot more about, I think, people and about how we can set ourselves up to constantly evolve what we bring to people, because it will never go back to slow development. In my view, it will only increase from here.
And what a lovely end note that we end on people and how people are the future, in the sense of the way that you've just expressed and talked about the design aspect. Thank you so much for giving me this time and opportunity to speak to you. Obviously, I'm a big fan, so I'll carry on reading the newsletters, going onto the website. I haven't done the cookbook yet in terms of future foods, but I am. Have you just out of interest? Have you had the coffee cake that they talk about?
We had the luxury of having the chef and food designer in the lab for
oh wow
Yes, so like all of the recipes, also the ones who didn't make the book, I think I've tried them all now, some with more success than others.
Yeah. Well, as soon as this lockdown period is over, I'm definitely going to be over to see, because you remodeled your studio as well this year as well. So I'd love to see the space in itself. Thank you once again. And sorry, where can people hear more about your work?
So space10.com is likely the mothership where you can find most of our content and projects. You can also follow us on social media at space10 or follow me at Kaave Pour on Twitter, where I often share a few sneak peeks on new projects.
That's brilliant. Kaave, thank you so much.
Thank you, man. Have a good day.
Bye.
The Retail Podcast. A global conversation hosted by Alex Rezvan-Bienetz.